Hi there. I'm always going on about the carbon credit economy and the fact that the debt that we have is actually representing burnt oil and we can never repay it for that matter. So if you want to see the global debt burden, you only have to look into the sky, because the sky consists for about 150 parts per million carbon dioxide, which is the burnt oil and actually the reserves we have. But economists are always very good at avoiding that topic. They're brilliant, actually. And here's an economist that is talking to Max Kaiser, or the other way around, or they're discussing economics with each other. And once again, they are skirting the issue, they're glossing over it, they're moving around it. And it's so blatantly obvious that the only thing that economists basically do is form an intellectual blockade between you and hard facts and reality, hard truth. You know, they can always come up with new concepts within their own theory. It's like I had a little bit of a beef with artificial intelligence scientists. You had Marvin Minsky and Daniel Dennett. Those people, maybe those names mean something to you. And I actually talked to them. I visited America and I met them. And the way that they talked about consciousness and intelligence was always in a circular reasoning pattern, because they never bothered to really look under the hood into the brain and see what's going on. And the same goes for psychologists and some other types of professions which are really about talking. Economics is really about talking about things and making sure that people keep behaving in the right way. And that means that you have to misdirect them, because otherwise you are solving a problem and you don't know, you no longer have a task. So here's the piece of Satyajit Das. He's supposed to be a rock star economist. That's as impressive to me as a rock star domino player. So here goes.
Not necessarily a rosy scenario. No. And I think that's basically about living standards contracting.
Right.
And basically, I think the whole issue about this global financial crisis, if you actually step back from it, is about the fact that living standards have been propelled by this steroid growth, which came from debt. And it was never going to be sustainable. Debt in small amounts was fine, but we just pushed the envelope. Human beings have an infinite capacity to take a good idea and make it bad by basically.
So there it was, you know. See if I can play it again. But
you don't need money if it's a subsistence economy.
Right, exactly. But I mean, in a lot of ways, the internet is becoming a subsistence clicking economy.
It's a different piece
where people are clicking and receiving minimal sustenance from ad revenues, just enough to keep you alive and clicking. So, I mean, that's not necessarily a rosy scenario.
No. And I think that's basically about living standards contracting.
Right.
And basically, I think the whole issue about this global financial crisis, if you actually step back from it, is about the fact that living standards have been propelled by this steroid growth, which came from debt. And it was never going to be sustainable.
You see, how can he say that, even? You know, he has to be completely insane. Just think about it for 1 second. How can everybody go into debt? That is not possible. Somebody has to have something, and then you can borrow it. And then you have to repay it, so as long as you repay the stuff that you borrow, you are in debt. Well, somebody had something in the world economy. The oil company had oil, and it sold the oil into the world in return for money. And the banking system did a trick with that money and made sure that it turned into debt. Which, so according to this economist, and that's just amazing, every time I hear people talk like this, and it's almost all the time, if it's economists, the debt propelled growth. Like, yeah, sure. Sure. And then he goes on, he says, yeah, but it's funny because, you know, actually this whole climate thing is quite serious, because it will mean that the resources are dwindling. Yeah, but that's also interesting. No, you're a charlatan, you're a clown. You don't know how to speak about things. You have no clue. You think it's still like a parlor game. Of course, let's say the best economists are just people that are happy to be intellectuals. That's what I have against this Canadian guy who also comes on the Max Kaiser show. He's very happy to use, let's say, delicate words or special words and feel philosophical. But at the, in the meantime, he's just not getting it at all. And he's basically a blocking issue for people with real brains. And I guess the whole essence of that is that if you're an intellectual, you have two types of intellectuals. You have the ones that have basically had a fair piece of reality and are and like reality and like to deal with reality, but they learn and they become intellectual. And you have people that simply hate reality, that want to be protected from reality. And as a result, they become intellectuals because you can, let's say, wander around thoughts and concepts and different ways of looking at things for hundreds of years, if you like. There's enough people in here. It's like, who cares what a philosopher says 200 years ago? You know, you can say it today. Nobody knows. Nobody will ever know. There's no profound thought in economics. It's just one big mistake. And I think all these people that call themselves economists and try to project into the future, what they're doing is basically reporting on a game in which they don't participate, which they don't referee, and which they don't even profit from. So I think it's quite a dumb profession, actually. But it's my opinion today, and check out the video. The discussion is interesting, but it's just, to me, it's gut-wrenching to see how clearly it avoids any real, let's say, specification of the problems and the solutions. It's just horrible.